The call to worship is from Psalm 24. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the rivers. Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in his holy place? He who has clean hands and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully. He will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob. Selah. Lift up your heads, O gates, and be lifted up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord strong and mighty, the Lord mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O gates, and lift them up, O ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts, he is the King of glory. Selah.
Our script reading today is taken from Romans chapter 1, verses 18 to 23. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men, who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely, his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made. So they are without excuse, for although they knew God, they did not honor, my translation reads, but the Greek behind honor here is the word for glorify. So I want to read it that way. For although they knew God, they did not glorify him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. All right, let's take a moment or two and pray. Father, we want to first begin by thanking you that you are our Father and our God. Especially in times of national or international crisis, we are made especially aware of our need of you. So we come to you, Father, and we ask that you would minister to us today, to us, to our nation, and to the world. I pray, Father, that you would be with our national leaders and with our country. I pray that you would give our leaders wisdom, help them, Lord God, to know what is right, and then help them to do what is right because it is right, because it would please you. Help them not to be swayed by peer pressure or other forces. Help them to remember, Lord, that they ought to please you in what they do. I pray, Lord, for our legislators. I pray for our justices. I pray for those in the executive branch, that all of them, Lord, might know what is right and do it. Then I pray, Lord, for those many, many folks who have lost loved ones in this COVID crisis. I pray first that you would bring comfort to their hearts. You said you're the God of all comfort. Give them comfort, I pray. And I also ask, strange as it may seem, that you would bring amazing good to each of these families. I pray that you would bring good out of this crisis for our nation. I pray, Lord, for those that are facing financial pressures because of the economy right now. I pray that you would help them to look to you, and I pray that you would supply their needs. I pray for our medical workers. I ask that you would protect them, give them wisdom, give them skill, and I pray that you would give them many successes, Father, in what they do. And along those lines, I think especially, Lord, of Kristen Hummel over in Italy. I pray, Lord, that for her and for many others working with Samaritan's Purse up at the Field Hospital in Central Park and over in Italy at the airplane hospital, I pray that here and many other places around the world where that and other organizations that are serving you are trying to help people that are suffering. I pray, Lord God, that you would bless them, protect them, guide them, enable them also, Lord God, to be successful in many cases in their treatment. And I also pray that you would enable them to share the wonderful love of God with the people to whom they minister. Then, Lord, I want to pray for the people who, because they are shut in, are lonely. And I pray, Father, that you would remind them that they may not have human contact, but you're always there. Teach them to lean upon you for strength, for fellowship, for encouragement, and show them, Lord, that you are more than sufficient for the needs that they face. I pray, Lord, that you would bring great good to our country and the world through this crisis. I would even ask, Lord, that you would use it to bring about a spiritual awakening in our land. We desperately need it. And Father, I pray you be with us as we look into your word in a few minutes. I pray that you would guide our hearts and minds, help us to learn what you would have us to. I pray that your spirit would use your word and minister to each one of our hearts. For Jesus' sake, amen.
Tabernacle, glory to the Lord. restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out.
Holy, 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 holy.
why are you and I here? Now, I don't mean by that question, why am I standing here talking and why are you watching on television? I mean, why are we here? Why do we exist? What purpose does our lives have? That's a question we ought always to keep in the forefront of our minds, but in a time of crisis, it is crucially important because our world gets turned upside down. So many of the things that are constant that we can depend upon aren't there. We need to remember why we are here, and we better have the right answer to that question. It's crucial because overall in life, we tend to depend upon the wrong things and have the wrong purposes for our living in our minds. For example, suppose an answer to the question, why are we here? We might say, well, we're here because of relational connections. We have loved ones. We're husbands and fathers. We're mothers and we're wives. We're children. Or we have friends. We're here for them. But if that's the purpose for our existence, stop and think for a moment. Because you see, all of those relationships will be temporary. And at a time like this, even more temporary. Because now you see, the people that we look to and depend upon for our purpose in life, they can be taken from us. Thousands of people know that. Today, in the days gone by, thousands more will learn it in the days ahead. Relationships cannot be the reason for our existence. Others might say that the reason for our living is to have the American dream, to have financial security. But at a time like this, it's easy to see how that financial security, that stability, can be taken away very, very quickly. For some, it may be a matter of the dreams that they've had. We live for those dreams. But at a time like this, it'll become abundantly obvious that any of those dreams can quickly become nightmares. What then is the purpose for your existence? What's the purpose for my existence? Back in the 1600s in England, in the city of London, a group of pastors got together, and they came together actually with the purpose of reforming the Church of England. And they produced a number of documents. They met for, I think, a little over 10 years from time to time. And as they worked together, they produced some documents. One of those documents is called the Westminster Shorter Catechism. The most famous question, probably the most famous topic that they covered in all of their work in that 10 plus years, was the first question and answer to the Westminster Shorter Catechism, because it addressed this very issue. The question they asked was this: what is the chief end of man? The answer they gave was, the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. To glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Were they right? Is that what the Bible says? Well, if you ask me, where in the Bible can I find a verse that says the chief end of man is to glorify God? I would have to say, it's not there. It's not there. Well, if the chief end of man is to glorify God, why wouldn't it be stated directly and clearly? Well, I think the answer is because God wants us to use our minds. Many things in Scripture that are very important and clearly true are stated indirectly. Jesus even did that with people. You remember when John the Baptist had been imprisoned by Herod, and he was becoming discouraged. And so one day he sent some of his disciples over to talk to Jesus with this question: are you the one who should come, or should we be looking for somebody else? John wondered why he's sitting over in jail when Jesus is out ministering. Why is John still there? He didn't understand. He didn't know God's plan. So he asked the question, are you the one we should look for, or should we wait for another? Now, when Jesus sent John's disciples back to John, he did not say, you tell John, yes, I am the Messiah. He didn't say that. What he said was, you go back and you tell John that the blind receive sight, the deaf are enabled to hear, the lame are enabled to walk, and the gospel is preached to the poor. Why did he say that? Because he wanted John to put two and two together from Scripture and come out with the right answer for. You see, Jesus knew that John knew that the Old Testament prophets predicted that when the Messiah came, those were the very characteristics that would be characteristic of his ministry. So if John remembered the prophecies, Jesus knew that he would, he knew them. If John thought about those prophecies and heard these words, John would have the clear answer to his question. Yes, Jesus was the Messiah. God sometimes gives indirect answers to questions that are very important. I suppose another is the Trinity. If you ask me, where in the Bible do you find the word Trinity? It's not there. Where do you find the words triune God? They're not there. But what I do find in the Bible is a reference to God the Father as distinguished from God the Son. At his baptism, God the Father said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." I also find that Jesus, the night before he was betrayed, said to the disciples, "I'm going to leave you soon, but I'm going to send another comforter that he may abide with you forever." He was talking about the Holy Spirit. And I find in Scripture that all three of those persons are referred to as God. They have the attributes of God. So the triuneness of God is clearly taught in Scripture, but not directly so. God expects us to use our minds. And so, in answer to the question, is the chief end of man to glorify God and enjoy Him forever? There are no direct statements, but I believe there are indirect teachings that make it abundantly clear that that is the reason for our existence. And I want you to look with me at a number of them. First, glorifying God is immensely important. Oh, I should have told you. I have four things I want to tell you today. The first one is, glorifying God is indeed the chief end of man. If that's true, then what does it mean? That's the second thing. The third is, all right, if it's that important and I know what it means, how do I go about doing it, glorifying God? And the fourth and last is, why should we do it? Why is it so important to God that He is glorified? All right, first, glorifying God is immensely important. Why? Well, Psalm 22, verse 23 reads, You who fear the Lord, praise Him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify Him and stand in awe of Him, all you offspring of Israel. Now, if you look at the context of this verse, in the Psalm 22, David had experienced deliverance from his enemies. And having experienced it, he praised God, and he exhorted everybody to praise the Lord, and he exhorted his fellow Israelites, all you offspring of Jacob, all of you, glorify the Lord. Now, the principle at this point was directed to Israelites, but the principle that lies behind it is directed to all of us to glorify Him. Paul says, for instance, in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, whatever you do, in whatever you do, glorify God. Do it for His glory. So God commands people to glorify Him, but not just people. He also commands heavenly beings to glorify Him. In Psalm 29, verses 1 and 2, at the beginning of a psalm which extols God for His control over nature, the psalmist wrote, "Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due His name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness." So human beings are commanded to glorify God. But heavenly beings are commanded to glorify God as well, the angels. And then, in Isaiah chapter 43, verse 7, Isaiah summarizes all those who will be brought back from captivity from the nation of Israel with these words, "They are everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made." Now, notice in this verse, Isaiah, by divine inspiration, well, actually, God is speaking through Isaiah, when he says, "I formed them for my glory. I created them for my glory." In essence, then, God is saying that believing Israel was created for God's glory. That's why they were created. That was the reason for their existence. And that applies to you and me as well. Created for His glory. But it's not enough that human beings and angels give glory to God. I found this interesting verse also in Isaiah chapter 43. In the future, even wild animals, believe it or not, are going to glorify Him. In the middle of a prophecy of the future, the Lord says, the wild beasts will, now again, the ESV reads honor, but the Hebrew word behind honor here is glorify. He says, the wild beasts will glorify me, the jackals and the ostriches, for I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people. Jackals and ostriches will glorify the Lord. Human beings are to glorify Him. Angelic beings are to glorify Him. Believing Israel was to glorify Him. Wild animals will glorify Him. But maybe the best is in Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. One day, everyone will acknowledge that Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. At the conclusion of that great passage which describes Jesus' emptying of Himself, Paul writes these words, because Jesus emptied Himself, because He became obedient even to the point of death, death on a cross, humbling Himself, therefore, Paul writes, God has highly exalted Him and bestowed on Him the name that is above every name, now listen, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow. Every knee should bow. And in case that's not clear, he says, in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, notice, to the glory of God the Father. One day, everyone will acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, and they will do so for the glory of God the Father. Now, there are just tons of more passages that talk about the importance of glorifying God. And if you're interested in this topic, God willing, in the next 2 or 3 weeks, Jason is going to post on our website under blogs some material that I've written on the glory of God. Lots more material there than I can give you, than I have time to give you this morning. So if you're interested in this topic, keep checking in at our church website under blogs and try to find the blog that asks the question, why are you here? Because that's the blog that will have the more complete information that I can give you today. All right, back to our study. So, glorifying God is indeed extremely important. In fact, it's the reason for our existence. Well, if it's the reason for our existence, what does it mean to glorify God? Well, weeks ago, I did a study on the glory of God, and I said that there are two ways in which the glory of God is used in Scripture as an expression. I said that one way is a reference to the glory of God in the sense of His attributes, manifesting His attributes, so that the glory of God is just who He is, what He's like. And I spent that half hour or so in that study showing from Scripture how one aspect, one sense in which the glory of God is used, is a manifestation of His attributes. I also said that there's a second sense in which that expression is used, and it's used of our response to Him. For example, we cannot add anything to God's omniscience, or His omnipotence, or His omnipresence, or His mercy, or His justice, or His love, or His truth, or His faithfulness, or any of His attributes. Those things are who He is. You and I can't add anything to who God is, but what we can do is to honor, praise, and worship Him, in essence, to give Him the credit for being who He is. That's what the Bible means by giving Him glory and glorifying Him, by giving Him the credit that He deserves because of who He is and what He has done. All right, if that's the meaning of glorifying God, Bob, how can we go about doing that today? Well, again, the Bible has lots of information, and I can only touch the tip of the iceberg. But let me share with you some of the ways in which you and I can give glory to God today. Ways in which we can give him the credit for who he is and what he's done. One way is by believing God's promises. Romans chapter 4. Romans chapter 4, verses 20 and 21. I'm dangerous with these things. These two verses, Paul rehearses Abraham's response to God's promise that he would have a son. And he wrote regarding Abraham in Romans 4, 20 and 21, "No unbelief made him, Abraham, waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith. He grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised." How was it that by believing God's promise, Abraham gave glory to God? Well, I believe it's because in the very nature of his believing God, he was giving God the credit for being faithful. By his faith in God, he was showing he was sure that God, having promised something, would fulfill it. He could depend upon the faithfulness of God, thereby giving God glory, giving God the credit that is his due, because he is faithful to his promises. And then we can also glorify God by praising him for the conversion of people. In Galatians 1, 22-24, the Apostle Paul is he's rehearsing part of his very earliest life as a believer in Jesus. And part of that description goes like this: "And I was still unknown in person to the churches of Judea that are in Christ." Now listen closely. "They only were hearing it said, 'He who used to persecute us is now preaching the faith he once tried to destroy,' and they glorified God because of me." So you see, the early Christians, they heard that Saul of Tarsus, who had been an archenemy of the cause of Christ, had now been made a new man. Old things had passed away. All things became new. He was a believer in Jesus, and he would become probably the greatest Christian missionary statesman the world has ever known. They heard that he who once persecuted the church now preached the faith he labored to destroy, and they glorified God. Why would they glorify God on the basis of what happened to Paul? Because he knew that only God could have wrought that change in the life of somebody like the Apostle Paul. Only God could bring about that kind of change. You know something? Only God can bring about the kind of change that you and I need to experience too. So as you and I hear of people who come to faith in Jesus, we ought to glorify God. Give him the credit that is his due. And then we can also glorify God by doing good deeds that reflect God's character. In the Sermon on the Mount, as a part of Jesus' instructions to his followers, he said, "In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." That they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. God has designed things, you see, so that as you and I live as the people of God, live as Christians, people will see the character of God in us. If not, we can help them by pointing that out. A few years ago, we had to have a cement step, stoop, put on the front of our house. And so a contractor came and gave me an estimate, so did some others, and I chose one, and he came and he made new cement steps for us. After he finished, he said to me, "Now, if you want to, you can give me this much money." He gave me a price. He said, "You don't have to add sales tax." I thought about that, and I thought, that's not right. And so I said, my boss wouldn't like that. I better pay the sales tax. He said, "Who's your boss?" I said, "He is." He is. Now, did he understand? I don't know. But I think the kind of thing we're supposed to do is something like that. As we do good works, and as time passes, they will show more and more, because we're living in an increasingly dark world. As you and I do things that would honor the Lord, as we obey Him and give Him the credit for it, people will see something that our world desperately needs to see. As we give God the credit, as we glorify Him for the things that we do. And there's another way that we can glorify God. We can glorify God by the way we use our spiritual gifts. That's the one I should have given you. Sorry about that. But now, 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 10 and 11. Part of Peter's instructions about the use of spiritual gifts was, as each has received a spiritual gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks, as one who speaks the oracles of God. Whoever serves, as one who serves by the strength that God supplies. In order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ, to Him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Now, Peter's telling us that if we're Christians, God has given us spiritual gifts. We can use them for our own glory, trying to get credit and praise for ourselves. But Peter tells us we ought to understand that each of those spiritual gifts is given to us by God to use for other people, with the ultimate object being that He would receive the glory. Sometimes I hear my Christian musicians singing. There's something about music that ministers to my heart in a way that even the best spoken sermons do not. And I'll listen perhaps to Steve Green, listen to a song that he sings. And my heart is so blessed, so blessed. But what I need to remember is that Steve Green isn't the guy who ought to receive the credit. God is the one who gave him that ability. God is the one who gave someone the ability to write that song and compose the music. God is the one who arranged for Steve Green to make that recording. God is the one who brought to my mind the importance of listening to it at this particular point in time. We need to understand that all of our spiritual gifts are from God. They're gifts from Him. They're to be used to benefit other people, but ultimately for the glory and praise of God. And then, one more. We can glorify God by living in harmony with one another. Near the end of his epistle to the Romans, Paul wrote, "May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with one another, to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ." Glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ with one voice. "Therefore," he said, "welcome one another," whoever they may be, "as Christ welcomed you for the glory of God. For I tell you that Christ became a servant to the circumcised," the Jews, "to show God's truthfulness, in order to confirm the promises given to the patriarchs, and in order that the Gentiles might glorify God for His mercy, as it is written, 'Therefore I will praise you among the Gentiles and sing to your name.'" Paul wrote to the Roman Christians. He'd never been there yet at this point in time when he wrote the letter. He wrote to the Roman Christians and he said, "Now look, I know that in the church at Rome there are Jewish believers and there are Gentile believers." And in essence, he was saying, "I know from my own experience that sometimes it's like oil and water. They don't want to mix." Now today, I don't think that division is so prevalent in the church, but other kinds of divisions may be. A lot of the problems we face in churches come because of what we charitably call personality conflicts. But you see, Jesus prayed that we would be one, in his high priestly prayer in John 17. And here Paul is saying, live with one another. Demonstrate unity. Why? For the glory of God. Because as people see that different kinds of folks can get together, work together, and love each other, different kinds of people, people from perhaps different races, people perhaps from different socioeconomic backgrounds, people perhaps having had different kinds of educational backgrounds, we can work together loving one another, encouraging one another, admonishing one another, comforting one another, laboring together. They will wonder, why in the world do these people behave this way when it is unnatural? And the answer, Paul says, is because God has worked in their hearts and helped them to see the unity of the body of Christ. And when they see that and understand the origin of it, they can give God the glory. All right, I've tried to look at the importance of glorifying God. I've tried to look at the meaning of glorifying God and how we can glorify God. I want to spend just a few moments on the question, why is it important to God? Why is it this important to God that we glorify Him? Why would it be the reason for our existence? Well, I suppose the first reason is because He deserves it. He just deserves it. And He does. But that's not the only reason. There is another reason why we need to glorify God. And that's because if we don't glorify God, we will be glorifying someone or something else. Because you and I are hardwired to thank people. I don't really care much to watch the Emmys or the Oscars, but I do see them from time to time, a little bit here and there. In almost every case, when people are given awards, they stand up and they thank this person or that person or this group of people for enabling them to do what they did that resulted in receiving this award. You see, we know that we ought to thank people. Now, sometimes people make crazy statements that I suppose they don't think about. Have you ever heard the expression, I thank my lucky stars? Well, I can't think of anything more ridiculous than that. I don't have any lucky stars, neither do you, and neither do they. But you see, we're hardwired to thank someone, to give them credit. Sadly, some people believe that they themselves ought to receive the credit for all that they are and have done. But the Bible makes it clear that God is to receive the credit for all that occurs. And when we don't honor, glorify God the way we should, what happens? Well, I want to take you to Romans chapter 1, a passage that I read for our scripture reading. And I want to just read through this slowly because it helps us to see what happens when we don't glorify God, when we give His glory to somebody else. Let me read it again and add a few verses. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who by their unrighteousness suppress the truth. For what can be known about God is plain to them because God has shown it to them. For His invisible attributes, namely His eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that have been made, so that they, mankind, are without excuse. For, although they knew God, they did not, now remember I changed the word from honor to glorify. Although they knew God, they did not glorify Him as God or give thanks to Him, give Him credit, but they became futile in their thinking and their foolish hearts were darkened. Claiming to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory of the immortal God for images resembling mortal man and birds and animals and creeping things. Now, what happened? Because they gave God's glory to other beings? Well, keep reading. Therefore, because they did not give God the glory that He deserves, therefore, what did God do? God gave them up. By the way, notice God gave them up in verse 24, verse 26, And verse 28, God gave them up. God gave them up in the lusts of their hearts to impurity, to the dishonoring of their bodies among themselves, because they exchanged the truth about God for a lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. So, the first step in what happens when people do not give God His glory is God takes His hands away and says, all right, you want to give glory to other things? I'm going to let you, but see how it works for you. Paul didn't stop there. He continues, for this reason God gave them up to dishonorable passions, for the women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature, and the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another, men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up, the third time. God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. They were filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil, covetousness, malice. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness. They are gossips, slanderers, haters of God, insolent, haughty, boastful, inventors of evil, disobedient to parents, foolish, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Though they knew God's righteous decree that those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them, but give approval to those who practice them. This was written 2,000 years ago. And yet, what Paul said is the result of giving God's glory to other beings, and the results of that, that's exactly what we see occurring today. When we don't give God His glory, when we give it to other people, including ourselves, when we give the credit, the worship, the adoration, the honor, the praise to other beings, there are no limits to the depths to which we can go. You see, it's very important that we glorify God, because if we give His glory to anyone else or anything else, the results are abominable. And we're beginning to see that in our world today. May God have mercy on us if we don't see that we need to glorify Him. You see, that is the one purpose for our lives that can never fail. You and I can lose everything, but as long as we have God, we have all we need. That's why He deserves the glory. That's why the chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. He has made us for Himself, and only in Him can we find fulfillment, meaning, purpose, satisfaction, and joy. Let's pray together. Oh, Father, You have been so generous to us in so many ways, and we confess that in the face of Your generosity, we have glorified people and things instead of You. We have worshipped Your gifts instead of the giver. And in many ways, in our culture today, we are reaping the consequences of that disobedience. Oh Lord God, have mercy on us. Help our hearts to remember who You are and what You are like. Help us to remember what Paul wrote earlier on in this passage. Your deity, Your godness has been abundantly demonstrated. You have revealed Your character, Your power, Your wisdom, Your majesty, Your goodness, Your graciousness, Your faithfulness, Your truth in so many ways. You have shown us that there is such a thing as absolute truth. So many times we have turned our backs upon You and the revelation of Yourself in Your manifested glory. And because we've turned our backs, we've glorified other things, people, or ourselves. Have mercy on us. Open our eyes. The God of this world has blinded the minds that believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, just shine to them. Satan does not want people to see Your glory. Help us, Father. Help us, Father, to show your glory to a world in which we live, giving you the credit that you so richly deserve. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.